The Cellcast is recorded in front of a live streaming audience.
Hello and welcome to another episode of The Cellcast. Joining me today is a man who, well, since it is a full moon, Dylan, did you turn him into a wolf again? Oh, sure you didn't. Welcome, Jacob. Need somebody get out the pepper spray.
Ram, wait, what? Run, bring it! What are you doing to me?
Deedlet. Turn him back. Okay, fine. Do it now, please. We got a show to do. See that shipment came in from Space Amazon.
Apparently.
Okay, haha. Jacob, will you hurry? Will you continue?
Thank you. Woof. Why, thank you.
Oh, great. You have fleas.
Apparently. Thanks, D-Lit.
Oh, you didn't spring for the flea protection plan. Yeah, thanks a lot.
Ow. I would sue somebody, but you can't sue Arpilus Intelligence yet.
Give him time. Yeah. Give him time.
Ow. Okay. Oh, we're good. Yeah, we're good. All right. Why, thank you, ladies, our co-host, a man who fell in love with a woman and realized she wasn't really a human being. Welcome, Drew.
What are you implying?
Francesca.
Not D-Lit?
Not D-Lit.
Good, because me and D-Lit are not in love.
Yeah, thankfully.
She's a thorn in my side. You better not aim that at me or I will unplug you. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Tonight, we are reviewing a Rankin-Bass classic theatrical film,
Mad Monster Party. Which I can't find information on that whatsoever.
I found it on Wikipedia.
Ah.
Well, so take that with a grain of Lot's wife.
That is true.
But, yeah, Mad Monster Party.
Ow.
Where we get every monster who ever existed, plus some that are still technically covered by copyright they didn't want to pay the royalties for.
Yeah, that's true.
Just a couple. Just a few. So before we get too far into this, why don't we go ahead and jump into our spoiler-free thoughts on this film?
Certified fresh and spoiler-free.
This is my first time watching it. This is my first time talking about it. My only knowledge of this prior to this was way back, nearly 10 years ago now. Every Halloween, we had this DVD on the shelf at Walmart, and I remember thinking, oh, this looks dumb. This is obviously a Rankin-Bass thing. This could be funny, stupid, kind of the funny kind of dumb, like,
yeah,
it's cute, you don't want to hate on it, really.
Right.
But you know it's going to be cheesy beyond belief.
Very
cheesy. And it is. But I never bothered to take the plunge.
Hmm.
Until I needed to put a movie on our schedule, and I thought, well, now's the time. So yeah, Mad Monster Party, it's a interesting little film.
A little.
I do feel like we should have invited somebody on this episode.
Agreed.
But we didn't know it at the time, and by the time we realized it, it was too late to get the invite sent.
That is true. Well,
Let's face it. We could have probably invited Marchand on that shorter notice.
Oh, yeah. Very easily.
But we did not because we know he's a busy man.
Yeah.
We have no, we know there's
stuck
a lot.
Stuck on islands, that kind of stuff.
Well, then you have, I don't think they've gotten, Kaguya's gotten married yet to Jimmy, but that's close. So we don't want to get involved in any of that stuff. I mean, it's going to be hard enough getting there
when the
time
comes. But yeah, because I remember the last time, like, I was over there, I think, we, like, had to get on the, a frog to get over there?
Dila is transporting us this time.
Yeah, thankfully.
Assuming the portal works. Because you remember the last time Dila used the transporter
for
us?
Yeah, that's true. Nearly got eaten.
We landed on an egg.
Yeah.
A well-protected and well-guarded egg.
I almost got eaten.
And we nearly pissed off an entire religion.
Yeah, apparently.
While we are not at fault with that religion.
Absolutely not.
Or with that religion's current fight with Mr. Marchand and the rest of the Monster Island peoples. We don't want to get involved in that mess.
No. So, I don't want to try to get eaten again. Definitely by, I don't know, let's see.
Mothra would not have eaten you. I don't think.
No, the little girl that wanted to keep me as a pet, remember?
Oh, that, once she was not going to eat you, she was she was going to love you and pet you and call you George.
But my name's not George.
neither was the nine-tailed fox she's hanging out with now.
Yes, exactly, thankfully.
But, and plus, I don't think George is a name that a South Korean girl would have come up with.
Probably not.
I was referencing something.
Yeah, hint, hint, nudge.
Anyway.
Yes.
All that to say, I have never seen this before. Hmm. We did not invite a certain person we thought about inviting later. But we didn't want to give him more issues than he's already having to deal with right now. And, yeah. This is an interesting little film.
Yes.
Jacob, what are your thoughts?
Spoiler-free-wise. Like Drew, this is my first... I'd never heard of this movie before. Two, when Drew put it on the list, I was like, what in the world? It took me a minute to figure out what the title was. I was like, Mad Monster World.
Party.
Sorry, Mad Monster Party. I thought it was Mad Monster World. It was Mad Monster Party. Had no idea it was a Rankin Bass.
It's using a 60s definition of mad, which just means crazy.
That is true. So,
mad scientist.
Yeah, it's Mad Monster Party?
Yes. Not that that's on the when you go to search for this thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's not on. That's not part of the title, but it is on the title screen, and so that's what I'm saying.
Yes. Yes. So watching this, I watched this the other day, and it was like, this is interesting. It's one of those movies that you can critique, but at the same time, be like, you know, it was done in the 70s. You know, it was that certain style. Mm-hmm. You know, it was with a budget.
And there comes a point in time where, yeah, you could probably nitpick this to heck.
Oh,
but
yeah.
To a degree, the things you would nitpick are part of its charm.
Agreed.
So maybe you shouldn't.
That's true, but as reviewers, you kind of have to go that line of...
Yeah, you have to butt up as close as you can without making anybody too mad.
Yeah, a level of respect for something.
Mm-hmm.
There are flaws with this movie, it is still enjoyable to watch. So this is going to be an interesting review. And I know we're going to have likes and dislikes for this film. Unlike mm-hmm. some films we've done, it's like, okay, we have no likes for this film. And so many dislikes, we're going to go into overtime.
And vice versa.
Exactly.
So, yes. Why don't we go ahead and jump into the spoiler-filled section on this?
Yes.
The following is a spoiler-filled review for the film Mad Monster Party. Listener discretion is advised.
Oh.
Mad Monster Party, was directed by Jules Bass, who would go on to direct The Hobbit. Animated Hobbit, not the Peter Jackson one.
Yes. In a certain TV show that came out like the mid...
They produced. They did not direct.
No. Thundercats. Oh! Probably my favorite show of all times. I don't care what you say. One of my favorite shows of all time. Now, granted, Lion-O, good night, dude. Grow up.
Anyway.
Yes.
It was also written by Arthur Rankin Jr.
Yes. Rankin Bass.
Mitch makes the Rankin Bass. Len Korobkin, Harvey Kurtzman, and Forrest J. Ackerman.
Yes.
Getting into the cast, we have a grand total of 4 cast members.
Yes.
We have Boris Karloff playing Baron Boris von Frankenstein.
And apparently one of his last performances.
It is the last performance in connection to Frankenstein.
Yes.
But he's also, along with being the original Frankenstein's monster, he was also the Grinch in the original 60s,
that's right.
How the Grinch Stole Christmas,
that's
plus
right.
The narrator.
Yes.
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch.
Nope, that was Tony the Tiger's
that
voice actor.
That is Tony the Tiger.
Not Boris Karloff.
That's what I automatically think of.
Right, I get that, but those Tony Tiger voice. Two different things.
Yes.
Anyway, technically. I'll admit, I thought they were the same person for a long time.
Exactly.
Gail Garnett voiced Francesca.
Mm-hmm.
And in My Big Fat Greek Wedding, the new movie.
Mm-hmm.
The new movie. The original, you know the movie I'm talking about.
Yeah, the OG.
Yeah. She played Aunt Lexi.
Oh, okay. I have no idea who this person is because I never watched the film.
It's been a long time, so I couldn't tell you who Aunt Lexi is either.
Gotcha.
But one of the aunts, I'm sure she was a big personality.
Of course. Big Italian family.
Greek.
Sorry. Greek. My bad.
There is a difference.
Yes, there is. My mistake.
It's the same difference between the Greeks and the Romans. Phyllis Diller played the monster's mate.
The monster's mate.
That's how they legally
named her. Say Frankenstein's bride.
No, well, I'll get to that. I have a question on that here in a minute. But yes. We'll get to that when we get to trivia. But in the movie A Bug's Life, yes. Another movie I don't think you've gotten around to watching yet.
No, I have not.
She played the queen of the ants.
Oh, okay.
Last, but most certainly not least, is Alan Swift, who played Felix Flanken, Yetch, Dracula, the Invisible Man, Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, Chef Machiavelli, the Captain, the First Mate, the Mailman, the Monster, and all other remaining male characters who I have not yet mentioned, including It. We'll get to It.
It later.
Yes.
Yes.
Kingdom Hearts connections. How many do you think we actually have with this cast?
A big fat zero.
A big fat zero.
Okay, good. I was like, I wonder who, because, let's see.
Swift would have been my only guess to have something, except I think he passed before Kingdom Hearts started recording.
Yeah, because I think it was in one interview, with like,
because there's only one person, well, there's only one cast member left.
Yeah, she's in this film. Alive.
Yeah.
So played Francesca.
You'll get to that.
Yes.
What do we got in info and stuff, if anything?
Oh, we have a little bit here and there. All right, so IMDb has a 6.6 out of 10. Rotten Tomatoes is a 7 from critics. And its audience score is 68. I watched it on Apple TV, but you can rent it on Amazon Prime Video, YouTube, and Apple TV, and many others for $3.99.
Okay, before we continue, I want to ask you a question.
Okay.
What aspect ratio was your viewing of the film in? Was it 4:3 or was it full widescreen?
It was widescreen.
Okay, mine was full screen. 4:3. On YouTube.
Really?
Yeah. What the heck?
Yeah. So, no correction. Be like, it was full screen. I'm sorry.
It was 4:3?
It was 4:3.
Okay.
It was 4:3.
Why is this the only version that we have on streaming? Because later on, we'll find out that they have a recent Blu-ray that's at the correct thing.
The correct
thing. Correct aspect ratio.
Yes. All right, so.
Which I can't imagine this on Blu-ray, but still.
Yeah. Probably a nice, crispier, and you can see all the flaws.
See all the breaking of the celluloid,
right?
Which you can still see some of that here.
You can see all the strings.
Continue. Sorry.
All right. Production was Rankin Bass Productions and was distributed, at least here in the United States, was by Embassy. I'm saying that right? Embassy Pictures. Had a runtime of 95 minutes. Was released on July 26, 1967. I could not find any information on box office, but apparently Drew did.
I didn't find box office. I found out it was released in theaters.
Oh, okay.
That's all I know.
Oh, okay.
I found no numbers. I just saw released in theaters.
Yeah, so.
Because this is a theatrically released film.
Yeah, because I think I saw something about that, but could not find anything on a budget. Couldn't even find, like, box office numbers. Nothing. And, like, probably Drew's going to find it.
Just going to Google real quick. You keep talking.
Yeah. So, let's see. Besides not having any home, like, box office information, Drew might find that in a moment. Home release. The film has been available on video for years. Its first original distribution was Embassy Pictures Home Entertainment Unit
and then other independent labels before Studio Carnal. Studio Carnal acquired the rights to the film. Currently, Lionsgate distributes the film on video under the license of Studio Canal.
Canal?
Huh?
Canal?
Canal. Sorry. There again, I can't read very well sometimes, so I do apologize.
You're fine. I'm just making sure that's what you meant.
Yeah. All right. So, pick up where I was. Before Lionsgate's current video release of Mad Monster Party, almost all video releases have been on 16mm film and were very poor color quality. The original film negative was water damaged some years ago, but Sony Pictures Television, which now holds the television rights, eventually unearthed the original 35mm print. This print was digitally remastered, and its source and is the source for the current DVD issue and all subsequent television showings. Anchor Bay released the previous DVD on August 19th, 2003, then re-released it on August 23rd, 2005 with additional features. On September 8th, 2009, it was released as a special edition Blu-ray by Lionsgate. The special editions include a documentary including interviews with cast, with production and crew, voice actor of Alan Swift, storyboard artist Don Dugan. I'm going to butcher that name. I apologize. Music and others. The film was released on Blu-ray on September 4th, 2012. And apparently there is a related film to this. Rankin Bass produced a related TV special called Mad, Mad, Mad Monsters from the ABC Saturday Superstar movie series, which aired on September 23rd, 1972. This Halloween special, Halloween feature, many of the same monsters named Bob Thedden. I'm going to butcher names. I apologize. Bob Thedden did his interpretation of Carlisle when voicing Bernard Henry von Frankenstein.
Baron Boris von Frankenstein.
No, it's Henry.
Oh,
Henry.
Well, Bond, so it'll be Baron, not whatever you said.
Who's related to the character? The animation for the special is provided by, again, I'm going to butcher this. I apologize.
You see that? Turn it a little towards me. Oh, Osamu Tezuka.
Okay, Osamu Tezuka. And
if I remember correctly, that's a very important name.
Yeah, I agree. I recognize it. Yeah, because I looked at it, I was like, I'm going to butcher this if I try to say this.
In fact, I'm 90% certain I know who this is. I feel like I'm losing geek points.
It happens. Produced like some like really.
I think this is like the big guy. Yeah. The big guy in anime.
Yeah,
this is the big guy in anime. Yeah. This is the guy who made Astro Boy and Kimba the White Lion.
Oh, okay. Well, that makes sense.
The big guy.
Yeah, the big guy.
He's the reason why we have manga and anime, period.
Exactly. Yeah, the guy who literally, you know, thinking about it now, the guy who was literally inspired by Walt Disney.
Yeah.
So, either way, it's like, yes, that's all I have for an info and stuff. Unless Drew has more.
I was unable to find anything else.
Okay. So
there literally is not a lot of information on this
film.
No,
there's not. So apparently there was a theatrical release, but there's no information about it.
It just technically was released to theaters.
Mm-hmm. It could have been released.
Or a theater.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Probably one theater, one night.
Maybe. Anyway, summary.
Yes.
Scientist Baron Boris von Frankenstein achieves his ultimate ambition, the secret of total destruction. Which is odd that destroying is harder to do than creating life in this universe.
Yes.
That seems backwards.
Yes.
Anyway.
Because it's so easy to create life in this universe.
Having perfected and tested the formula, he sends out messenger bats to summon all monsters to the Isle of Evil in the Caribbean Sea. Okay, this is the second week in a row where we've had something in the Caribbean. We had Florida last week with the castle in the Floridian swamp.
Yes.
And now we have this out in the Caribbean.
Yes.
I don't think I realized finally why this area is such a hotbed for these movies. Mm. Why I didn't recognize this last week, I have no idea. The Bermuda Triangle. Why did I not think of the Bermuda Triangle last week? Mm-hmm. It starts in Miami. That's it where does. It is on the mainland.
It does.
I've been through the Bermuda Triangle. I should know this anyway. The Baron intends to inform them of his discovery and also to reveal his imminent retirement as head of the Worldwide Organization of Monsters. Besides Frankenstein's monster, most of the time referred to this as Fang, and the monster's more intelligent mate, who reside on the Isle with Boris, the invitees include Count Dracula, the Mummy, Quasimodo, referred to as the Hunchback of Notre Dame, the Werewolf, the Invisible Man, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and the Creature from the Black Lagoon, referred to as simply the Creature. The Baron's beautiful assistant Francesca confirms that all invitations have been delivered and inquires about one of the addresses, a Felix Flanken. Frankenstein explains that Felix is his nephew and successor to in the monster business. This displeases Francesca, who covets the role for herself. She asks why there is no invitation for it. Boris replies that it was not invited since it can be a crushing boar, explaining that it even crushed the island's wild boars in his bare hands the last time it was invited. Felix Flanken is a drugstore pharmacist somewhere in the United States, incompetent and asthmatic, but good-natured. He is a constant burden on Mr. Cronkite, the greedy owner. A mailman arrives with Felix's invitation, and he joyously accepts. He boards a freighter headed for the Isle alongside Dr. Jekyll and the Werewolf, among others. The ship's crew are wary of their unusual passengers. Frankenstein has his zombie butler, Yetch, Chef Mafia Machiavelli,
yes,
and the zombie bellhops and servants make preparations for the upcoming party while patrolling the aisle to ensure that it does not arrive uninvited. The monsters begin to arrive on the freighter that Felix is also traveling on. During dinner, Frankenstein shows that the formula, which he will demonstrate the next day while naming his successor. Francesca secretly meets with Dracula to inform him about Felix, promising to share Frankenstein's secret when she becomes a successor if Dracula were to get rid of Felix. When they catch the monster's mate eavesdropping, she and Francesca begin to catfight while the other monsters have an all-out food fight. Felix arrives to the island and is greeted by his uncle and Francesca, who take Felix on a tour of the island where the mummy, the werewolf, and Dracula plan to attack. While the human Felix proves to be unsuitably kind-hearted, the monsters nonetheless plot to eliminate him and gain control of the secret formula. But Felix continually accidentally foils their attempts. Later, Frankenstein tells Felix about his retirement, making his nephew leader of the monsters in the world. Felix naturally feels reluctant to take the job. Over time, Francesca develops feelings for Felix after he obliviously saves her on multiple occasions. As Dracula, Frankenstein's monster, and the monster's mate descend upon Francesca, she sends out a letter via messenger bat to an unknown recipient. When the monsters corner Felix upon capturing Francesca, they are frightened at the arrival of it, who is in fact a giant gorilla. And let's face it,
King Kong. Except brown.
Who proceeds to rampage since he was not invited. It snatches up the monsters and Francesca, on whom it develops a crush.
There's a surprise.
Yeah. Felix rushes to tell his uncle what happened and is instructed to head to the boat. Frankenstein leads... Frankenstein leads the zombies in rescuing Francesca from it using biplanes. Boris invites it to let Francesca go to take him instead. It complies. Felix and Francesca manage to escape the island in the boat as Frankenstein and the remainder of the monsters remain in its clutches. Displays that the monsters tried to steal the secret for themselves and intended to kill Felix as well as having to put up with it. Frankenstein sacrifices himself by dropping the formula, destroying the Isle of Evil and everything on it. That is it, the island, not it, the giant King Kong knockoff. Mm. The destruction is witnessed by Felix and Francesca offshore. Felix expresses a desire to begin a family with Francesca, who tearfully admits that she is not human, but is in fact a robot creation of Frankenstein's. Felix responds that none of us are perfect, mechanically repeating the last two words, indicating that he is his uncle's robot creation, too.
I didn't catch that.
I don't think he actually is a robot. I think that's someone taking what was on screen a little too
much.
Literally. I think it was mostly him just being funny.
Apparently.
Anyway, getting into the trivia. In order to keep costs down, the film's producers did not want to pay royalty fees for the use of the names King Kong, the Frankenstein Monster, the Bride of Frankenstein, Quasimodo, and the Creature from the Black Lagoon. That is why many of these characters, though recognizable, are all called by different names. Mm-hmm. King Kong is it. The Frankenstein monster is Fang. The Bride of Frankenstein is simply the monster's mate. Quasimodo is called the Hunchback of Notre Dame. And the Creature from the Black Lagoon is called simply the Creature. The names Count Dracula, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and the Invisible Man were in the public domain at the time of the film's production. And thus, as no royalty fees were required for their use, they were allowed to be used in the film. Among the many talented people who worked on this film are several who did not work in films very much. One example is noted cartoonist Jack Davis, best known for his work on Mad Magazine, of which he is a co-founder. Mr. Davis was a character designer noted for his characters with distorted anatomy. His outrace style gave Francesca her quite ample bosom, which was not typical in kiddie entertainment.
No, it wasn't.
In her stand-up comedy routine, Phyllis Diller, the voice of the monster's mate, referred to her husband as Fang. She decided to use the name when referring to the Frankenstein monster, whom her character is married to in the film, because that was what she was used to. The producers decided to allow it since they were unable to use the name the Frankenstein monster. Yet they were allowed to say Dr. Frankenstein.
Agreed. It's very weird.
I am confused by that, but we'll continue. Actually, they never did call him Doctor. They always called him Baron Boris von Frankenstein, which is entirely different, I guess. As of 2022, actress Gail Garnett, who voiced Francesca, is the only surviving cast member of the film. This was one of the six feature films produced by Arthur Rankin Jr. and Jules Bass. Most of their other work were specials and cartoons made for television, primarily airing during the Christmas season and Saturday mornings. Although it was constructed in Academy ratio, that being 1.33:1, which is a widescreen ratio, the film was intended to be screened in a 1.85:1 widescreen aspect ratio, which is wider. It has never been released in its intended aspect ratio on either television or home video, not even on Blu-ray. However, the widescreen ratio can be obtained on a 16:9 televisions by using the Zoom 1 setting. But we have an update to this apparently already. As of May 24th, 2023, this is no longer correct. A gorgeous new Blu-ray is now available, featuring a new 2023 color-corrected master in the correct aspect ratio of 1.85:1 and the alternate full-frame 1.33:1. That still doesn't change the fact that I watched it in 4x3. But that's all I have for the trivia.
Gotcha.
What is your first like for this film, Jacob?
All right. First like for our film would be the design. Like, the design of the characters. You're dealing with really, you know, very professionally made stop motion. Because they're going to be like, you can't really... Like, stop motion is such a unique craft that when it is used, when it is perfected in the way that it is magic, Like,
and if there's one thing you can most definitely say is the Rankin Bass style is nearly perfect in its stop motion.
Agreed. So my first like would be the design of the characters. Be like, yes, these are stop motion figures. And but like the detail, be like you look at Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde when he transforms. Mm-hmm. Be like, it's cheesy as all out, but it is absolutely just gorgeous to look at. You have the Wolf Man or Wolfie, or as Count Dracula calls him, Wolfie.
Yes.
Like his design, I love. Be like Francesca, how they design her. Mm-hmm. Like every character except for like the Mummy. The Mummy's kind of a boring kind of character design. It's very like slapped on. Be like, okay, that's a mummy.
Yeah.
But overall, like design of characters is done very well for a stop motion film in the 1970s or late 70s. But I do have a so when I do the cover art for this episode, mm-hmm. I have a few ideas. I think it's gonna be fun. So yeah. Good time. So, yeah, design.
My first like for this film actually is the stop motion, but I want to throw extra attention towards water. Because yes. This film has a lot of water in it, and the water in this, which admittedly is like a blue cloth with like white cheesecloth kind of on top of it in a way.
Mm-hmm.
It actually looks very. They did a very good job of animating around that. Where, yeah, agreed. I mean, it's obviously not a liquid, but it works in such a way where it's like I don't care for the most part. But the stop motion throughout the whole thing is like spot on.
Agreed.
There's a couple moments, like we said, where you know you can see the strings.
Yes.
But at the same time, we're seeing the strings because we're watching it on an HD television.
Yes.
We're going to see strings. We're going to see all the little imperfections. But in this instance, it's like the stop motion. There's a couple of moments I'll talk about later where it does kind of fail a little.
It does.
But for the most part, the character animation and the object animation in this, I think, is spot on for what it needs to be.
Agreed.
But it's the water that really kind of impressed me because they did a good job of animating the water. It's not like spectacular. It's not like the Lego movie where all the water is made out of Lego, you know, and it kind of moves like water kind of is supposed to, which makes sense. It's CG. It's really more of a flat thing, but it looks far better than specials that you know, the holiday specials that took place on water. It looked more believable.
Yeah, it did.
For that. It still looked fake, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But you're going into this watching, it's like, yeah, this is fake. It's stop motion, and it's obviously stop motion. You are not supposed to be reading too much into this.
No.
But yeah, the stop motion animation, particularly on the water, is my first like. What's your second?
All right, so I'm going to go in that same way with the stop motion, because there again, be like, whenever, when you see stop motion, like, again, in the 70s, it was very heavily used.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, it is a lost and dying art. Be like, you will see films every once in a while. Like
Leica is our only bastion of this style. You see a couple other places where we get a little bit better, but honestly, Leica is the last place you get good stop motion regularly anymore. Aardman's starting to do it again.
Yeah,
Aardman's actually been doing it a while back, but theirs is more claymation than stop motion.
Yes, and like you see those like little bastions of it still today.
Mm-hmm.
I think of like they just try to mimic nowadays stop motion. Like you obviously you can't do it like the way they did back then. So whenever you do see it, it's like you're just like in awe. It's like, wow, how many years did they put into that? 3 to 5 years.
Well, and, I mean, the last one we saw before watching this was Guillermo del Toro's Pinocchio.
That is true.
Which I was not sure half the time if that was stop motion or CG because
That's what
the animation was that good.
Yeah, it's incredible. If you haven't seen that, go see it. Go see it on Netflix. It's good. Mm-hmm. But overall, be like, you see something that is stop motion, that is like legitimately stop motion. If it's good, bad, or ugly, be like, yeah, it's just like, wow, the time, mm-hmm. dedication, and effort they had to put into that. It's just props. Be like, if there's errors or something like that, be like, hand drawn, okay. CG, okay.
Yeah, you can go back and fix some of that.
Yeah, you can go back. Like this, you can't.
Not really.
Yeah, because it'd be like, it takes like, yeah, just be like,
it takes hours to produce like a minute of animation.
Yeah, just hours and hours. You see, it'd be like in this one, you can tell they definitely took some shortcuts,
mm-hmm.
and it's very glaringly obvious. But overall, it'd be like, I do appreciate the art of stop motion, because this is done very well for a movie that has a lower budget, and
oh yeah.
It is fun to watch. It is fun to watch these, you know, these claymation characters move around.
Mm-hmm.
It's fun. So yeah, the stop motion.
My second like for this is going to have to be the character of, is it Flynn? The human. I think it's not Flynn.
No, it's not Flynn.
It's Felix.
Felix. Yeah.
Felix. Flanken.
Yeah. I think Felix Felices.
Well, I think in my mind I was thinking Flynn
Ryder?
I was thinking Flynn Flanken instead Flanken. Of Felix Flanken.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about the same. The thing is, you can tell he's doing a what's his name? The guy from now my brain is just dying.
It's Friday. It's
understandable. Yeah, it's Friday. That's my only excuse. But the actor from It's a Wonderful Life.
Jimmy Stewart.
Jimmy Stewart. You can tell he's doing a Jimmy Stewart impression for this character. At first, I was like, when I was watching this, I go, man, could you have recorded this any quieter? Because half the time, it feels like you're quieter than the rest of the cast, mm-hmm. which I didn't realize he was half the cast.
Yes, oh my gosh.
He was most of that cast.
Yes.
But at the same time, it's like the longer it was, like, yeah, this guy is obviously going to be the twerp who's going to win.
Mm-hmm.
I knew that kind of after just a couple minutes. But they did such a good job with that character of making you like, you didn't, he was annoying, but funny, and you didn't hate him,
mm-hmm.
even though he could have very easily been hated very quick. So yeah, that's my second like, is actually Felix Flanken.
Gotcha. All right, so my third like. So every time I try to figure out, just pointing out a character that I really, really enjoyed. And I was like, okay, like this character kind of shines, even though it'd be like he's more of a background character. Mm-hmm. He's still part of the crew. Woofy. The Wolf Woofy. Man. Woofy. Woofy, my good friend.
I'm sorry. I was thinking Dracula.
Yes. Like, I enjoy the character of Dracula. I really, really do.
Yeah.
But be like, to kind of point to a character that's not really, be like, he's part of the big group, but more mm-hmm. he growls and snarls and be like, his design is amazing. The way they animate him, the way that the voice actor, who's the voice actor for him?
Alan Swift. When in doubt with this film,
yes, Alan Swift. Yeah, Alan Swift does an amazing job because all he does is growl. He growls and snarls and like howls. Because
mm-hmm.
we do see him very briefly in his human form, but he never reverts back. He's woofy the entire time.
Yeah,
which I thought was hysterical. The fact that he acts more like a dog than anything. He's not really he's a wolf, but he acts more like a dog,
mm-hmm.
and he's just like. Like him and Drac are best friends. Like, it's just great. I love it. And again, be like, Woofy is going to make an appearance in the cover art. Just saying.
Of course.
So they're going to be like, he's in most scenes, but he's more this background character. Be like, he's just a fun character. I mm-hmm. really enjoy it. And like, there's no other real like descriptor. Be like, he, like, when Felix? Not Felix. You just said his name a minute ago.
The human?
Yeah, the human.
That's Felix.
Yeah, Felix. Yeah, when Felix and Francesca go running off, be like, obviously the monsters are after them the whole bit, and the point where Felix is like, he's like, when the first time he interacts with Wolfie or something like that, it's just like, oh, he's such a good doggy.
He's such a good boy.
He's such a good boy. It's like, you realize he's a monster, right? It's like, no, he's a good dog. He's a good dog. But yeah, just I enjoy that character design. I was like, that is creative because he's got this big jowl. He looks ferocious, but he's actually kind of a fun loving wolf that just happens to turn into a wolf.
Right.
Yeah. So yeah, Wolfie. That's my third like for this film.
I'm gonna give it up my third like up to actually Alan Swift.
Yeah, agreed.
This voice actor,
yes,
is voicing almost every character in this. The ones he's not are the ladies, for obvious reasons, and Boris Karloff's character.
Yes.
Which the only reason he's not is because Boris Karloff is obviously stunt casting.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact is, until I was looking at this cast list, mm-hmm, I had no idea this entire, almost every single person in here was being voiced by Alan Swift. Everyone from Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and both those kind of voices, mm-hmm, to the sniveling Igor character, gosh, Igor Yelch, character, who is keating on the gorgeous Francesca, who is obviously doing an impression of this actor from the 30s who the Warner Brothers cartoons also made jokes about, whose name I cannot remember. But it's like he does such a good... He's got all these voices. He's like... He is 75% of this cast. No, he's 90% of this cast.
Yes,
agreed. And you don't know it. Like, I think of other people who I know have done similar things, like Chris Sabat with Dragon Ball Z, where he's most of the cast, it seems like. And you know it's all him because you can hear the Christopher R. Sabat in every single voice.
Every voice.
In this, you can't hear Alan Swift in it.
No.
Half the time. This is like when you find out that how many people... Frank Welker has voiced that you would have no idea that was Frank Welker until you looked it up.
Exactly.
How many films have we watched with Frank Welker in it? And I couldn't tell you before looking at credits that it's Frank Welker.
I couldn't. No. It's uncanny.
Or you can kind of hear Mel Blanc in a lot of his stuff, but that's just because we've seen so much Mel Blanc. It's kind of hard not to hear him in a lot of stuff. He's kind of just the guest. It's like, oh, you don't know who that is? Probably Mel Blanc.
Probably.
Or with the women's roles, June Foray, and all the stuff she's done. When you have one of these actors who, you know, have 1,001 voices that they're able to pull, and you don't realize that it's the same person having a conversation with themselves 10 times over.
Yes.
That is impressive to me.
It is very impressive.
I need to look up what... I need to go back and look and see other things that Alan Swift has done, because if this is the only thing where he actually did, like, a majority of the cast, and he's just not, like, all over everything... Like, I do remember. I did forget to mention in the cast list what Alan Swift is also known for voicing.
Really?
I somehow skipped it. Do you remember the show Underdog?
Vaguely.
Speed of lightning, yes, roar of thunder.
Yes.
The main villain of that was a man by the name of Simon Barr Sinister.
Oh, of course.
Voiced by Alan Swift.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so yeah, I at least know him from something. Alan Swift is like the best thing about this film because, yeah, he is kind of... spread thin, don't get me wrong. He is very spread thin in all these roles, but the fact is, if you don't know that that's one guy,
yeah,
you'd never know that it was one guy.
No, you wouldn't.
He even voices, like, all the gurgles you hear from the creature from the Black Lagoon and, quote-unquote, It.
It or Mummy.
The
or...
roar of It.
Yeah.
It's like, good night. You would think that something like this, they would have borrowed, like, the Godzilla roar that was already going through the
studios,
sound effect libraries at this point. But no, it's not even something like that. It's like, no, this is literally, they got him in the studio, and he made roaring noises for It.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, kudos
yes,
to agreed. You, Alan Swift. You deserve far more, I think, than you got.
Yeah.
For with this, especially with this particular production.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Alan Swift is my third like for this okay. film.
Nice.
So there are things that we dislike for this film. Mm-hmm. I think a little bit more than we have the last week or even week before last.
Mm-hmm.
What is your first dislike for this film?
My first dislike for this film, the jokes get old really fast.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because it'd be like, obviously this is a kid's movie, so you're making kids laugh. But at the same time, you're dealing with adults. Adults are having to watch this and it's like, this is getting boring really fast. Because they're going to be, you're playing into all the monster tropes.
Mm-hmm.
And be like, oh, I want to suck your blood and blah, 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 blah. Be like, you hear the joke that got under my skin the entire time
mm-hmm.
was Felix Hay Fever. Like, they do this 6 to 7 times the entire movie. It's okay. We get it.
We get it. He's got allergies. You never tell us what he's allergic to.
No, he's just sneezing to everything.
He's allergic. And it's, can't even claim it's one of the monsters because he was sneezing in the pharmacy.
Yes, he was. It'd been funnier if he was allergic to Wolfie or something like that. Or be like, he's like...
Or Francesca.
Or French. Oh, my gosh.
That would have been hilarious.
That would have been hysterical.
Oh, I'm allergic to 10WC30 motor oil. Oh, no, that's what's in my blood.
Yeah, exactly. That would have been hilarious if they would have explained it, like what the, you know, what he's allergic to. And it's like, okay, that clues you into something, but they never did.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the jokes got really old really fast. And it was like, oh, okay. Oh, ha, ha, ha. Oh, he's a nod to Frankenstein. Oh, he's the mummy. He's, you know, the invisible man. Oh, how many times do you see him, Dr. Jekyll turn to Mr. Hyde?
4 times.
4 times.
I've got questions about that here in a minute.
Yeah, or Wolfie, for example. Be like, Wolfie, be like, see him transform once. And how
during
many,
the opening.
During the opening. So, again, kind of like in the same vein like we did last week with Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein. Because they're going to be like, I think it's like the, in some cases, the full moon can last for 3 days.
It is this weekend.
Yeah. Oh, believe me. Believe me, because I had someone joke at work. It's like, did you bark so much yesterday? It's like, yes, I did, because of my Tourette's. I barked mm-hmm. like 4 or 5 times. And it's like, no, because it's not the moon. It's just like bark every once in a while. It's Tourette's. But,
you weren't howling at the moon. That's not the actual lyric, but whatever.
No, it's not. No, it's not. But my wife doesn't, like, she kind of rolls her eyes every time I howl at something. She's like, I can't help it. I'm a goober. I can't help it. But it's just like, yeah, like you get like Wolfie. He's Wolfie the entire time. He mm-hmm. like he's a Wolfman the entire time. There's no transformation back. Like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, but like apparently his wears off. But we know, be like there are cores. There's this doesn't take place in one night, does it?
This acts like it's well. I think earlier they said the thing was supposed to take place. It was supposed to take a week. Felix was going to be gone a week.
Yeah, he was going
to
be gone.
He had to get down there and then come back. But the way they made this sound like it was 2 nights.
Yeah, 2-3 nights.
Yeah.
So yeah, of course, like Wolfie would turn back into a human, but you never see that. All you see is his wolf form or his werewolf form.
I
understand you're trying to be like. Building that motif, but you do it with Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
I refer you to last week where I said that the werewolf technically can change when there's not a full moon.
That is true.
It's just he doesn't have a choice when there's a full moon.
That is true. That is true. But I think it would have been...
Like, no, I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
Trust me. The fact that he doesn't change while Jekyll and Hyde do change all the stinking time.
Yeah.
Because it's always Jekyll to Hyde, never Hyde to Jekyll.
Yeah, so I think it would have been...
There's a bigger problem with Jekyll and Hyde. Yeah, I'll get to it in a minute.
Agree. They play into that way too much.
I'll get to it in a minute.
Yes. But if we would have seen like his actual human form at one point, you don't have to be like, oh, it's this actor. Be like, you can just be like, oh, it's, you know, Joe Schmo, like whatever his name is. Like just at once where you see him transform or something like that. Like, obviously, it's limited, it's a budget, that kind of stuff, but it'd been cool if they would actually, you know, had him transform once or twice or 3 times. It'd been kind of cool. But yeah, just kind of nitpicks, like usual. What's your first dislike of this film?
The lack of attention to monster backstories.
Yes, agreed. I wonder why.
Let's start. First off, I can kind of survive the Frankenstein moving his operation down to the Caribbean. I can live with that.
Yeah.
That's a minor thing.
Yeah.
Dracula can't be transported, can't go across a moving water outside of his coffin.
Yeah, which that's...
And yet he does it here.
Mm-hmm.
The Wolfman, like we said, never transforms.
No, we see it once.
The mummy apparently has to stay in a sarcophagus most of the time, which that kind of works.
It's the gag, but at the same time, you're dealing with... Dracula doesn't have to be in his coffin at all.
Why is Quasimodo evil in this? Quasimodo is not evil in his source material.
No, he's
not. In fact, this actually shows scenes where he is working in Notre Dame, a cathedral, a place where light shines.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's owned by the Catholics, so take that for what it's worth. I'm just saying, I don't care one way or another, but I have some friends who would say, well, there's your proof. But here's the thing. That is still a church building. As far as we know, Quasimodo is a born-again Christian.
Well, we understand.
As far as we understand. And yet, here he's just evil, and no explanation as to why.
No.
Because he works for the evil monsters. So he's evil.
So here's a question. So at one point, I remember Dr. Frankenstein mentioning like all his creations. So did he create all the monsters?
No.
Okay. It sounded
Dracula
like...
Dracula technically should predate him.
Yes, should. But I'm just like, Frankenstein...
When he was referring to that, he was referring to the monster and the mate and Francesca.
Oh, okay, that makes sense.
It's the only three characters he could have been referring to.
That's what I kept thinking. Is like, could
but he, at the same time, the way this explained the science was like, well, I don't know.
Yeah,
that best if they're saying his monsters, it's only because he was the leader of the organization of monsters.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Anyway.
So that was my question. It was like, did he create them all? Because he is a mad scientist, so he can create all these things.
That's the thing. It's like, technically he shouldn't, because then why would they all be situated around the world? Especially when we've talked about a couple other characters here. Yeah,
true.
Secondly, Jekyll and Hyde. Dr. Jekyll himself is not a monster.
No.
And he's not evil. In fact, the entire point of Jekyll and Hyde, the story of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, is that Mr. Hyde is the evil half, while Dr. Jekyll is the good half. Why is Dr. Jekyll being so cordial to Mr. Hyde by paying the money to travel to the Isle of Evil and making the decision to transform back into Mr. Hyde to let Mr. Hyde go out and have fun?
Yeah, just...
That doesn't make a lot of sense.
No, definitely the source material.
And then, there's probably stuff wrong with the creature from the Black Lagoon, but I don't know that stuff enough to know that.
Well, I think with the creature from Black Lagoon, be like they do make the joke and be like, oh, is he out of water? And we don't really see him outside of water except for like twice.
Yeah, and then you have it, as he's called in this,
right?
AKA King Kong, which. Not only, this is actually the exact opposite problem, so I'm going to talk about it later.
Okay.
But
not the clown.
No, not the clown. Literally, when they kept saying it, I was trying to picture in mind, who could it be? Are they referring to Pennywise? No, this has to be before King wrote that book. So it's not that. Is it, I literally thought maybe this was another word for the blob. Because that would be interesting. That's like another classic monster. Or maybe the thing from outer space. But no. It is King Kong. I'll talk more about him in a minute. But the fact that there are some characters in here who their lore is blatantly obvious.
Yeah.
That they are being misused.
They are.
Because it's like somebody wrote down, okay, we need a list of monsters. Here's the big ones. Dracula, Frankenstein's monster, The Mummy, the Wolfman. Mm-hmm. What else we got? Well, we've got the Creature from the Black Lagoon. Okay, we'll throw him in there. We got Bride of Frankenstein. Ah, that's a love interest. Well, let's hire Phyllis Diller for that for some reason. We've got The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Mm-hmm. What's his story? I don't know. I've only seen the movie once, and it was a long time ago. Oh, we won't worry. We'll just keep him in the background. He's just a monstrous form figure, but we'll call him the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Yeah.
I'm sure the Church of Notre Dame loved that, by the way.
Oh, probably.
Completely ruining the character that made them famous.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, the misuse of character backstories that are painfully obvious to anyone who has ever paid attention to classic horror literature. What is your second dislike?
My second dislike for this film is going to be the third act.
You mean
when it shows up?
You mean King Kong?
Yeah, when King Kong shows up.
You mean the actual, let's just cut every plot point from King Kong and throw it on screen?
Exactly.
Congratulations, you've just unlocked us to covering the same point at the same time.
Exactly.
Because this was my second dislike as well.
Oh my gosh.
Because it's King Kong!
Exactly!
It's like didn't even hide that it was King Kong. You could have just said he was a great ape and then not done anything with planes or climbing to the top of tall towers while holding on to beautiful women that he's obviously in love with.
Exactly. Good. I was like, what the crap? Because they're going to be like, okay, Drew watched this like what? 24 hours.
I watched this. I had no idea who it was.
No.
Right? So I'm watching this movie and, you know, you got Felix backed up against the ocean while the monsters are trying to get to him. And this great ape climbs himself up out of the ocean going, what up? Don't tell me that's it. Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
Is that, because I knew that's pretty much who Francesca Call said the thing to. It's the only person she would have. Is that it? It's like, and it's like, okay, so they called a giant ape. Surely, this isn't King Kong.
Yeah, it can't be.
It can't be.
But he looks like
I do love the line. I do love Felix's line. Hi, sir, can I interest you in a banana?
That
or
was
something
good.
Like that.
That was good.
And I'm just thinking, okay, it's a giant ape. That's nothing new. It's just going to be a giant ape that they called it. 15 minutes later. Oh, yeah, this isn't King Kong at all. He's just on top of the castle holding onto a hot woman in one hand while jet planes shoot at him.
Biplanes.
Gee, I wonder what this is.
Yeah.
And I posted this to our Facebook Messenger group.
Mm-hmm.
Folks, if you are not in our Facebook Messenger group, you are missing lots of fun.
Yes. So go join where you can.
So I posted, I paused the movie, I took pictures, and I made references. And I have no idea if you ever saw them.
Oh, I did.
But it was before or after you posted?
Before.
Because the next thing I know, 24 hours later, I'm in here like watching Star Trek. I probably. Mm-hmm. And you posted the same stuff I did as if you had no clue it was going to happen either.
Well, okay, for my defense, I didn't know where it was in the film. 24 hours later. So I'm watching this film while my wife, my wonderful wife, is... No, wait a minute. This was at Bible study. Like, she was at Bible study.
She was at Bible study.
Okay. Yeah, on Tuesday. You watched it on Monday.
Yeah.
So I'm watching this. It's like, no way. No way on earth. And then it turns literally into the third act of King Kong, beat by beat.
And I think we both thought, we should invite Nathan. Nate.
Yes, exactly. Because then we would be like, okay, stop the movie. Here's the third act. They're like, how good is this related to all the other King Kong related stuff, Nate?
At least this is stop motion, unlike everything else past the first movie.
Yes. Oh my gosh. I was like, wait a minute. Okay, we're going to pump the brakes for it to show up, and then we're just going to recreate the third act in King Kong.
Mm-hmm.
With all of our characters. Stop every single...
Every plot line we had going up there. It's just... Yeah. I think it's even after that point. Francesca finally falls in love with Felix.
Yes.
It's like, you weren't in love with him 5 minutes ago. You hated the guy.
Yeah.
And now you act like you've never known a man as hunky as him before. It is a 180 degree turn.
Oh, agreed, agreed. It's more be like, oh, I'm distressed and I'm in peril. Oh my gosh, this dorky guy saved me. Oh, I'm in love with him. Cliche.
Yes.
And he's just like, what in the world? Like, why in the world are you stopping everything for this? Like, I know you want to homage King Kong, and I know you don't have the rights to King Kong. But dear Lord, why? Like, do something different. I understand. Be like, oh, let's just do all the tropes. Oh, it's
every
a big
trope.
Every
trope.
Single trope.
Like,
oh my
like
word.
Like, the fact that Universal Studios did not wrongly sue you for this film is amazing.
Exactly. How do you keep on your radar with that?
Because I like to point out, if y'all don't know, the King Kong copyright situation is so convoluted and so hilarious when you actually it's so dramatic when you actually read what actually happened. They need to make a movie about it, ending with Nintendo giving the middle finger to Universal with Donkey Kong.
Yes,
that whole situation is like, I can't believe that carnival of errors occurred.
Yes, but I was completely, utterly flabbergasted watching this. Okay, you hear about it, because I keep thinking it is some kind of wild, crazy character who comes in and just wrecks everything. I nowhere near in my mind, I kept thinking this would be a King Kong ripoff.
If they'd have said Kong or Giant Ape or
Monkey Man, something like
that. I would have accepted the Kong connection at that point, but you just called it. And the fact is, even in the opening credits where it listed all the monsters as starring roles, it put it in quotation marks.
Uh-huh.
Like, it's like, we know what it is. We can't say what it is.
Yeah.
We know it is. We know what it is. You know what it is. We know you know what it is. And we know you know what it is.
Exactly.
But we can't say that's what it is.
Yeah.
It's like, really?
Yeah, I'd be like, with this third act, be like, I understand you want to homage, you know, a classic character in a classic film, but you pump the brakes on everything you're doing in this movie to make this scene. Obviously, you'd be like, King Kong grabs all the monsters in one hand.
Right.
Including Dr. Frankenstein.
And then gets Francesca in the other hand.
Yeah.
No, Dr. Frankenstein's not in that group.
That's right.
Because he has to trade places with Francesca.
Yep, that's right.
So he can throw his beaker with the...
Yeah, I was getting there.
Stuff that causes everything to disintegrate.
Right. Yeah, it can blow...
So he can sacrifice himself and the rest of the monsters.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
It's one way to take care of everybody.
And the movie kind of just wraps up, be like... Oh, I'm in love with you. We can get married and have, you know, more
robo babies.
Yeah, more babies. And it's like, oh, Mila, I forgot to tell you, I'm a robot. Oh, that is a matter that sounds like our modern day world, doesn't it? Just a little bit.
We all have our problems. Our problems. Nobody's perfect. Perfect.
So, like, here's a question. Here's a question with that. Does that imply kind of like, hold on. I want to call it Running Man, but that's not it. It's the, come on. Don't you love it when you have a thought and then it goes away? And you're like, I know I have the thought in my head. It's like, why are you not?
You mean when I couldn't think of Jimmy Stewart's name earlier?
Yeah, exactly.
Because I can.
Yeah, now you get Jimmy Stewart in your head. Blade Runner. It's got this Blade Runner.
Do androids dream of electric sheep?
Yeah. Or does, like, a human, is he actually human or is he a robot?
Well, that's a good question. Here's what I actually think. I think he's actually a clay puppet used for an animation and it doesn't matter.
No, you think?
No, really, I'll be honest. My thought is Felix is too, not ditzy, what's the word I'm thinking of? He's too klutzy. He's too klutzy to be a robot. You can't program that.
Yeah, agreed.
So he's got to be a normal human who is, when after she bears her heart out to him.
Or her mechanical heart.
Her mechanical heart says, my heart is made of steel. There's oil in my veins. I was the doctor's creation, but unlike Dr. Frankenstein, I am basically a robot. And Felix goes, oh, well, nobody's perfect, Francesca. Perfect. Felix, that is this. She ought to punch you right now.
Yeah, agree.
She ought to punch you into the ocean and then sail away.
Yeah.
Because you are not funny.
No, you're not.
Is very rude because she just poured her mechanical heart out to you and you made a stupid joke.
Yes.
That's what I think. If you want to ask me what Felix is, even though he was my favorite, one of my favorite characters in the film, he's a bit of a rude jerk who really needs to fall into the ocean at the end. But anyway.
But yeah, that's the third act just like throws you for a loop. It stops every traction. What they were doing in this movie just to make a homage to King Kong, which is not King Kong.
Yeah.
It just drove me nuts. And it's like, oh, okay, so this is how you get rid of all the monsters.
This is how you end the film. You blow them up.
You blow them up, and then they go sailing away.
Sail away.
So, yeah, third act was just so irritating.
So, since that's covered both of our second dislikes, what was your third?
Third act, just in general, when you're dealing with animation, dealing with, like, anything that is handmade, you are going to have errors. Mm-hmm. And apparently this movie was a very low budget. Again, could not find a budget for this film whatsoever.
Right.
Apparently,
but it had to have been low budget. Yeah, this is only a little bit better than most of the Christmas specials.
Mm-hmm.
Which we know had no budget.
Yeah, had no budget whatsoever. This had a little bit of a budget, but you can see the animation flaws.
Mm-hmm.
You can see where they're taking a lot of shortcuts. They're taking where you would animate on ones, they're animating on threes, maybe fours. Or maybe even fives in some cases, where a character is just skirting across.
There is one scene where all the characters are still and the entire movement, and it's just like 15 seconds,
mm-hmm.
is the camera panning down.
Yes, agreed.
So you can see Orville and Wilbur Frankenstein's planes. Yes, you heard me.
Yes.
Orville and Wilbur Frankenstein.
Yes.
Not right. Frankenstein.
Yeah, Frankenstein.
They make it very clear that those were cousins of Boris.
But yeah, just, oh my gosh. Animation errors in this movie are rampant.
Mm-hmm.
Are rampant. Or claymation or stop motion animation errors are rampant all over this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, it's one you can point a few out. Like you can watch like Frosty the Snowman or Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer and be like, you'll see them, but you ignore them.
Yeah.
This is just so blatant in every little corner. It's just like, oh my gosh, what are you doing? It's again, be like, I've done claymations before when I was in seventh, eighth grade. And like that takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of time. Definitely you're doing it by yourself.
Because
I did it by myself because there again, I'm stubborn. Anybody who knows me, it's like, duh.
I wasn't going to say anything.
But it's like, yeah, claymation, stop motion animation takes forever to do anything. And be like, again, be like, you got to give those guys props for what they did with this mm-hmm. film. Be like, it's done to a professional level, but it's done with a very limited budget. And you can see it all over this film.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I wish Rankin Bass, I always say Franken Bass, but it's Rankin Bass. Rankin Bass would have given them a bigger budget. They probably could have done a lot better, and this probably would have. What you're saying, it's a cult classic film now.
It is now.
It's a cult classic. Back then, it wasn't.
I suspect this didn't actually do well in theaters.
No. But apparently, it's been on video ever since then. Just more,
yeah.
It's well, one of those
it's
things.
It's like all of the Rankin Bass Christmas specials.
Yes.
No one's going to go into this and say, oh, these are Oscar-worthy films.
Mm-hmm.
They are what they are, and Crunch and all, they're beloved for the, those things.
Agreed.
So.
Agreed. So, yes. Yeah, it does have animation errors, but it is still very... You have a reverence towards mm-hmm. it. So what is your third dislike of this film?
During the monster party itself,
mm-hmm.
there is a scene where I don't remember how many other characters were doing it, but at least the monster's mate mm-hmm. was dancing.
Oh, yo,
and
gosh.
It was supposed to be legitimate dancing.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the model did not have that much articulation. No. And it looks bad.
It does.
It was like one of those moments where it's like, maybe you shouldn't have wrote this scene considering the limitations of your medium.
Yes.
Maybe you should have done something else.
Agreed.
You kind of wrote yourself into this problem. And the cat fight between her and Francesca at that's not far from that moment is about as bad. It's yes. like,
oh, agree, it is terrible.
You were not. This thing was not redesigned for this. Why did y'all decide to do this? It doesn't work, and it's not. It doesn't work in a way that, you know, is. Where it's quirky enough mm-hmm. that you can kind of admire it for its quirks. It's you're watching and going, are we sure they're dancing and are we sure they're fighting? Because it could be, it's vague enough. They could be doing anything.
Yeah, agree.
Up there. And that's as far as I'm going to take that illusion. It's that moment where you're looking at it and going, this doesn't work. Everything else in this film works to a degree. This is just something that doesn't work. And I wish they hadn't have even tried and just stuck with what they knew they could do very well.
Yes.
Because this cat fight and dance scene,
oh my gosh,
both of which involving
abysmal.
The monster's mate, mm-hmm. who, no offense to Miss Phyllis Diller, they did try to make look like her.
Yes.
But the model is very flattering.
No, it's not.
To Miss Diller. Not really at all. But and in all fairness, she didn't actually do a good acting job with it because you could definitely tell it's Phyllis Diller.
Yes.
But yeah, it just doesn't look good. And that's why it's my third dislike. Which brings us to the end of the film. We need to rate this thing.
Mm.
What are you rating it?
I'm curious where you're at.
Like I think I've said a couple of times in the last month and a half.
He ain't half bad.
Ain't half good either.
I appreciate this for its quirkiness. I want to like it for what it is far more than I think I actually do. There's a couple of weird little things that made me go, I know this is quirky and this is for the time, it's the best they could do, but I don't, there's parts of this, it felt like it drug, like it just didn't need to be a feature film. This Fair. Could have been, you could have cut about a half hour from this, including all the music, which I didn't get to, but yeah. If I had a fourth dislike, it would be the music.
Yes.
Because the songs didn't need to be in this half the time. I probably am going to rate this a 6.
A 6. Okay.
It's quirky. It's fun. I'm not going to tell you not to watch it. It is got this culty horror classic comedy kind of mm-hmm. thing. It's fun that if a group of people said, hey, we're going to sit down and watch this crazy thing, I wouldn't walk out of the room. I'd sit down and enjoy it with them because this is the kind of movie I can expect enjoying watching with a group while you're making mm-hmm. fun of it.
Yeah.
In terms of, am I going to ever watch this by myself again? No. This is a 6 at best.
Fair.
What are you rating it?
I'm going to be in the same boat. It's a 6. Maybe not for the exact same reasons. I think if someone was playing this in a room, I'd probably sit down and watch it. And it's like, wow, just be like, the animation is done very well. Again, mm-hmm. if it had a bigger budget, it'd be better. But I think if someone said, be like, hey, I bought this for you, you know, as like, a gift.
Oh, gee, thanks.
I'd be like, thanks, I appreciate it. Would I watch it again? Maybe. To watch it on Blu-ray? Heck yeah.
Yeah, at least give it that. Especially yeah. if it's the ratio it's supposed to be at.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and not the pan and scan we were watching?
Exactly. So be like, yeah, if someone gave me the film, you know, gave me a Blu-ray copy, be like, yes, I would happily take it and watch it again. I don't know if I would watch it again after that. But I'd be like, I enjoyed this movie for certain aspects of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not one of these movies I'm going to go out of my way to go and buy the film again or yeah. rent it or go buy the Blu-ray. If someone wants to donate or purchase this Blu-ray for mm-hmm. me, I will gladly accept it and then watch it again in its proper ratio.
Yeah. Especially if they've got a version that doesn't have the really bad, obvious film degradation
yes.
at that one point. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, the film goes yellow.
It does.
And not a good color of yellow either.
Yeah, except of water damage.
It looks like Wolfie used the restroom on it. But that's the end of that part. Join yes. us on the other side of these bumpers. I don't know where I was going. I'm sorry. That threw me.
That threw you.
Join us on the other side of the bumpers, and we're going to get to some Spy Family.
No, hold on. What are we watching next?
Oh, next week, Blood, the Last Vampire. With a special guest.
Yes.
Assuming
everything works out.
Assuming everything works out.
Yeah.
I don't know why it wouldn't, but you never know. You never know.
Yeah, because this particular host was on the last episode I believe we did with him was
a long time back.
Yu-Gi-Oh!
I don't remember if Yu-Gi-Oh! Or Batman the Long Halloween was last.
That's right. Those were fairly
around the same time.
Yeah, roughly the same year.
I want to say Batman Long Halloween was last.
That is true.
Well, except he was on during the Heron hiatus.
Yes, he was.
But join us on the other side of the bumpers, and we will get to talking some Spy Family.
This podcast is a proud member of Culture Box. Whether you enjoy geeky reviews, comedy, or original fiction, you can open up the Culture Box and find something excellent for your soul. Point your web browser to culturebox.media.
This week, we suggest checking out Geek Devotions. Geek Devotions is a collaboration of devoted geeks that are devoted to letting people know that they are loved. They produce a weekly geek culture-infused devotional, their podcast, Com Talk, and written articles, all designed to encourage and challenge people in the geek community, bridging the geek between their faith and their geekdoms. You can find all their content at geekdevotions.com. The Cellcast would also like to thank the following patrons: Ashley and Francisco Ruiz, PaulJPowers.com, The Monster Island Film Vault, and Edwin Gonzalez. If you would like to have your name shouted out on the show, some special art from Jacob, uncut episodes, and then for an additional $5, the ability to force us to watch something within reason, mm-hmm. please donate to us on Patreon. Also, if you are watching the live version of this episode, you will see that me and Jacob are sporting our brand new Halloween 2024 t-shirts. Mm-hmm. They will be disappearing on October 31st. Bear that in mind.
14 days from now.
Indeed. So go get your shirts now.
Yes, if you want them.
If you can't get to their show notes and see our link there,
yeah,
get in touch with us. We will personally send you a link to the website.
Mm-hmm. And also look out for more design coming up.
Yeah, we got some stuff coming.
Yeah.
Bond.
James Bond Jr. Impossible. Call me big man if you want a rich man when you want to page me.
His name?
Shh, secret squirrel.
Johnny Quest.
Anybody want to feel it?
Mission 32. Who is this mission for? Originally aired on November 18th, 2023. It adapts the last half of Chapter 48, along with Chapters 49 and 50. And we are still in the middle of the crew's adventure arc. This episode was directed by Shogo Ono and written by Daishiro Tanimura. In this episode, Lloyd tries to impress Anya and picks out outfits to make him look like a fun dad. Meanwhile, Yor on guard duty is confronted by one of the assassins, Barnaby, as the attack by the assassins intensifies. Yor questions her own identity.
Mm-hmm.
Getting into the trivia for this. This is the first and only time an episode release date has been announced before the release time of its previous one. Unlike the previous episodes that started at 11 o'clock Japanese Standard Time, this episode was released 15 minutes later.
Huh.
And I don't know why. This episode's key visual is the final of the three in a large-scale main visual element. This also marks the third and currently final time that an episode visual shares its image with visuals of other episodes, thus making the overall picture. Yeah, I think I failed to mention that the last two were all part of this bigger collection. That,
oh, okay.
When you saw this visual element, I don't know where you look at these visual elements. I'm just going off the trivia, but yeah, this key image. When the assassin leader goes to sniff out Ulka's old cabin, one of the perfumes he smells is Blue Lace number 89. Mm-hmm. In the manga, the name of the perfume is Blue Lace number 88. I don't know why that makes a difference, but it does. In the manga, it is unknown who exactly called Ulka in Zeb's flashback. In this episode, the person turned out to be her late father. Matthew's silencer has a logo with garden shears on the grip panel in the manga, while the symbol does not appear in the anime. While Ulka's group goes to rest, Yor has an additional line in the anime saying that she will turn off the lights. Matthew's radio has a slightly different design from its manga counterpart, with some components being changed. In the manga, Matthew's radio has a note showing other channels in the anime. This note does not appear. That's basically all the trivia I've got for you in this episode. Jacob, what is your thought on this episode?
This movie just kicked. This episode just kicks.
Yeah.
Like no one's business.
And this
like,
is not
it's
even
just lit the, beyond
this
belief.
This is not even the good episode yet.
No, it's not. But it's so entertaining where it's more Anya is trying to distract Lloyd, be like he's changing the whole enchilada, and she's wanting to watch your mom at work, and it's like you have this great inner dialogue, inner struggle with your that it's just like, why do I do this? Should I hang this up? If I hang this up, is this going to ruin what's going on now? Be like, is Lloyd going to divorce me? If like is like it's she's questioning who she is. She's questioning her identity. Why she does things. Be like the fact to be like she started doing this because she wanted to provide for her younger brother, and now she does it for what? What is her purpose in doing this? Mm-hmm. Be like, does she enjoy the job? Does she enjoy being an assassin? And I find that be like the when you're dealing with the characters' mental struggle with why they do things. It's so fascinating because you find when she is fighting the guy in the open, she can't, there's no, be like, you find it like where your succeeds, where she is like, she's strategizing everything that's going on. Be like why she does this and why she does this. If she does this, she does this. And then you have this, the outside factor that Anya is there and now she's afraid that if she does something wrong, like Anya could get hurt or killed, and so
well, and she's also
questioning herself.
She was also worrying that Anya's going to recognize her.
Yes,
which Anya reads her mind, says, "Oh, yay! It's the circus."
Yeah, the circus. I love that. I love the fact that like Anya engages the crowd to be like, oh, this is the circus. Oh, this is just an act.
This is a performance.
This is a performance. And so it turns into this amazing ballet of like the assassin himself be like, oh, I'm just going to take out the target, where it's your.
And he says, I may also have to take out everyone here.
Yeah. She hears that and be like, well, Anya hears it. Oh, my gosh. Like, this is really cool and really scary. And so you have this entire dance of like Yor is trying to be like she can't outright kill this guy, but she has to eliminate him in the most non-violent way ever. And it's how she like is able to choreograph where like the chain is going to strike, where she can wrap it, throw it into this direction to literally wrap him like he would do something with bacon. Just wrap him up. And it's done very well. She knocks him out. And then she's able to, with her...
She knocks him out in such a way that he bows right next to her.
Yes,
at the end of the thing.
It was like, great. Just fantastic. Okay. Fantastic. So, oh my gosh. Like, yeah, this is done so well. Done so well. And they again, be like, you're leading more into your questioning, like, why she does this. And be like, this struggle with conscience and struggle with identity and struggle with her purpose in life, which I know like a lot of us have done that. Be like, as a 40-year-old man, be like, I've struggled with that.
Yeah.
And like, believe me, you're not alone. You're not alone. Be like, it's not the end of the world if you can't figure out what's going on. But like, there's a bigger hope. And there's a bigger hope. There's a bigger joy than just our temporary afflictions. That, you know, in Christ, that's, you know, where we have hope. So
yeah,
if you're struggling with that, talk to somebody about it. But yeah, yours would be like she's certain to like understand why she's doing this. And yeah, remind me again, is like after that, I'm gonna go in blank because I watched this like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Let me find out real fast. Oh yeah,
this ends as they're talking about the fireworks, but that stuff has not started yet.
Yeah, that hasn't started yet. So,
because there is that day where they're sleeping off in the new cabin.
Yeah, they're hiding.
And
that's right.
Anya falls asleep on her feet, and Lloyd has to take her back down to the room.
Yeah, that's right.
And
that was a very sweet moment. And then
Anya wants to go find Yor, but can't ditch Lloyd long enough to do it because everything. That she does. She either gets interested in what it's doing, or Lloyd goes too fast for her to be able to escape.
Mm-hmm.
And they get all the way to dinner, and she was never able to get away from Lloyd.
No.
And Yor and the two people she's protecting are hanging out in the room, and the assassins can't find them.
Yeah.
Even though they kind of know what floor they're on.
Yeah. Got a sense of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, like you have this like start of identity crisis with Yor. And it was like really, it's really, really well done. And I just thoroughly enjoyed it. I thoroughly enjoyed this episode.
Yeah.
And then you get in the next episode. Oh, it's even better.
Let's just go ahead and get into that next episode. Yes. Mission 33, The Symphony Upon the Ship. I love the name of this episode.
Oh, it's so good.
Also, Sis's Herb Tea.
Herb Tea?
After the end credits, there was an extra little short.
Okay.
Originally aired on November 25th, 2023. This adapts chapters 51, 52, and 53, and short mission number 6.
Yes.
And this is still in the middle of the cruise adventure arc, but does not finish it.
Yes.
We've still got one more climactic episode.
Yes.
This episode was directed by Isao Kayashi and Yoshiki Kitai, and written by Daishiro Tanimura. In this episode, Anya and Lloyd are enjoying the fireworks. Meanwhile, Yor's mission has reached its climax. Trivia for this one. There are additional scenes of Yor dodging the swordsman's attacks before she is told to withdraw. As Yor reflects on what her reasoning for being an assassin is, there are multiple additional scenes. When Yor thinks of returning Anya's library books, there's an extra scene of Yor imagining Anya reading a book. When Yor remembers Yuri gifting her a bouquet of roses, there's an extra scene showing Yor holding the bouquet. And as Yor remembers why she became an assassin, there's an extra scene of the young Briar siblings together. Unlike in the manga, the assassin leader is positioned to Yor's right instead of her left. As such, Yor tears out her right earring to throw at him instead of the left earring.
Oh, okay.
Wow, this episode.
Yor is a beast.
And I got a lot more appreciation for the dude that is pretending to be the husband. The guy, because he's been kind of a scaredy cat for this whole time. Yeah,
agreed.
And at the last minute, as they escape into the hold of the ship, he actively he doesn't sacrifice himself because he's wearing a bulletproof vest, but he does throw himself into the line of fire.
He does
grabs the mother and the child. And they fall in there, and then he reaches up at the last minute to shut the trap door behind him. And you don't even know he had a bulletproof vest until they get in there.
Oh, yeah, it's hysterical.
Man, this stuff hurts! Even through the bulletproof vest. It's like, okay, you're fine.
Yeah, you're fine. You're going to be sore for a little while. You're
going to
be
sore, but you're fine.
Yeah.
And then you get into the good part. And then you get into... You're kicking some major assassin booty.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
Oh wow. And it's like this thing. There is music in the background, but they didn't time it to that, unfortunately. But there's still so much of her kicking people's tails up and down the ship, all without giving any notice or. To any of the passengers who are also outside watching the fireworks.
Exactly.
And this includes the multiple times people get thrown off into the ocean.
Yes.
And also, past these people.
Uh-huh. And also you got to think about, like, Matthew, her boss, is there just...
Kicking butt, sniping
people's butts off the ship. Uh-huh. And, like, he gets in the fray. It's like, oh my gosh. The
part where he gets down there and he's pushing that mop... First, just to clean up the blood, but then just wields it like it's a weapon of mass destruction. Here's an interesting thing, though, about Matthew. The character of Matthew is one of the things the manga writer regrets not designing him better. He designed him as a generic character because he didn't, way back in like the first couple of chapters, not knowing he was going to use him as the go-between. Between Yor and the rest of Garden. But still, he kicks some butt here, too.
He does.
Like, I didn't realize... I knew this guy was a killer, but I didn't know he was that much of a killer. Because he looks like an old dude. Doesn't look like he'd be that spry anymore. But, oh, man.
Oh, my gosh.
This whole bit. This is a 30-minute episode?
Yeah.
And it goes by so fast.
It does.
Because of all of the action. When the end credits popped up, I thought, no, this isn't the end of this episode, surely. And technically, it wasn't. But what was there was not what I was wanting to see. I was wanting to see Yor get up and kick these last three guys right off the tail end of the ship. But save that for next episode.
Yes.
But yeah, this is it's such a good, fun episode.
It is.
I like Lloyd's biting commentary on the whole thing, where he's talking about Anya and how he can't understand why she enjoys watching the same thing over and over again.
Yes.
Meanwhile, we're cutting back to Yor kicking these guys' butt over and over again, and we're all enjoying it.
Yes.
So, this is such a fun episode.
Yes, I agree. Be like, now correct me if I'm wrong. Be like, is this the episode where she finally finds her purpose?
At the very end.
Yeah, the very, very end.
Right before the credits, she finds why she's going to get up and take these last three guys out and her customers can get to safety.
Yeah. So again, be like you're dealing with that. You're dealing with, be like, Yor is getting her butt kicked, and so like she is wiping the floor with some of these guys, and then others she is getting literally pounded, and she's having these mental struggles with, be like, if I die,
be like, if I wind up dying, be like, what's going to happen with Lloyd?
Oh yeah,
what's going to happen?
That flashback apparently to when they were setting the mission up, and Matthews said to her, it's like, if you are killed or disfigured enough that you can't go back to the mission, we're just going to tell Lloyd you had an emergency transfer.
Yeah.
I'm going, that still wouldn't work, even if Lloyd was just a psychiatrist.
Yeah. It also be like you're dealing with the idea of being like, she is at the point of defeat. She has a knife blade at her throat.
Oh, it's not a knife blade. It's a freaking katana.
Okay. Katana. It's a katana blade. Katana blade at her throat.
And she reaches up, grabs the sword blade, and breaks it in half.
Yes.
How, like, this is why I love Yor.
Because she found her purpose.
She found a purpose of why
she has to do this.
And the thing is, it's leading up to what's obviously going to be, okay, she's about to kick these three guys' butt, and...
Credits. It was like, what the crap?
I understand what you're doing.
Yes.
That's great. No. And if we were going all the way through this thing, if we were binging it, I would not care.
Yeah.
But because we started... Because the first time I watched this, I had to wait a week, and now I have to wait another week, despite the fact I saw the next episode. I know what happens, but I've got to wait. This is when you know they're doing it good, is when you're annoyed that you have to wait.
They're pacing it out, which is really good storytelling. Yeah,
they've paced it out enough. It's like, will you just get in there and kick their butts already, or...
So, kind of leading into the end of this episode, you have Yor, who is at the edge of death. She is contemplating why this and why this. And so she has to dig deep within herself to find what is her courage, what is her strength, why does she do this? And, like, the entire episode, she's like, oh, Lloyd and Anya are nothing to me. They are just, like, they are part of my cover. They are part of this. And all of these other things, she starts to realize that she does love these two people. She's starting to grow on.
Yeah, it's the culmination, not the culmination, but it's what the show has been doing this whole time. Where, yes, this is a family of convenience.
Yes.
They are each covering, they're each other's cover story. Mm-hmm. They don't know that that's what they're doing for the other person, but they are. But the fact of the matter is, all three of these people are now a family, and that's what makes what I still say is going to be the inevitable conclusion of this, is when you've got Twilight versus Thorn Princess.
Yes, that is going to be epic.
While they're all, with Anya, like, being held in the experimental facility that originally birthed her,
like that.
And they have to come together to realize they're on the same side, even though they work for different countries, and they are a family, and they are going to go save their daughter.
Yeah.
Not Anya, their cover daughter, their actual daughter.
Yeah. That's going to be epic. Like,
that occurs, because that's not in the manga. Yeah. This is just my assumption of how this is going to have to work.
Right.
It's the only ending I will accept for this. It's just getting to that point.
Yeah. So, again, you have this wonderful duality of, like, what does she do? Why does she do this? But, like, again, we all struggle with that. And I freaking love it. I love it when they deep dive in psychology of African characters' motivation and why they do this and why they do this. And Yor finds hers. It's not for country. It's not for this. It's for my brother. Even though, he's grown up. It's to save those I love. And that concludes Lloyd and Anya. And so she finds that inner strength because she was beat. She was out for the count. And then she found that inner strength to break the blade of a katana. Right? Like, at the knife edge of death, at her throat, she breaks it.
Yeah.
Like, you realize how strong a katana blade is.
Well, I mean, Japanese steel is fairly weak. That's why they had to bend it so much. But still.
True.
Still.
Good night. I was like, oh my gosh, I can't wait. And then they go.
Ending credits.
You poor soul. Oh my gosh.
Yor is apparently so bad a cook she couldn't even make herbal tea right.
Right. And it's this lovely little story of like how Beatles, her brother is sick when they're younger, yeah, and she doesn't and
so
know
she,
how to.
So she talks to other people. She's like, "Oh, you should make an herbal tea." Mm-hmm. And instead of going to the store and buying herbal tea mix like a normal person,
yeah,
she goes and finds the herbs herself.
Oh, it's a plus
the honey, which means she fought off a bunch of bees.
Yes.
In fact, I think she still got like bee stings on her.
Oh, she did.
And while she was out, she also killed a boar. So they're having a hot pot tonight. I was like, oh, that boar died in vain.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. And it's like,
that's another thing I want to bring up is earlier during that fight, like the last major enemy before the last three blew poison at her.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're all watching. It's like, that ain't nothing. Her cooking was worse than that. She survived that. What makes you think that she's not about to come right through that thing and punch you in the mouth, woman?
It's like, what? She survived my poison? Whack!
That's enough poison to bring down a bear. Well, she took down a bear herself once.
Yes. To save her brother.
Yeah.
And she could have gone down to the market and got the tea, but you know,
that would have been far easier.
But this is your.
That's okay. She couldn't have boiled that water to save her life anyway.
No. Like, and again, what's the brother's name again?
Yuri.
Yuri is telling one of his superiors about this whole story.
Right. And it's just like, he asks him to go and get the tea with the bear on the box.
Yes.
And the guy comes back and says, "You know, this stuff's supposed to taste horrible, right?" Right. And the guy says, "Well, yeah, but this is the closest I've ever been finding to the tea my older sister used to make me." Mm. I go, "Oh wow, this must be like the Metamucil, Benadryl, crud of the century,
pink stuff."
Yeah, this is Pepto Bismol that is being cooked into an herbal tea.
Yes, oh my gosh, no. But yeah, it's absolutely just like this. You took this serious note, and then it's like, okay, let's get to the brother and play some laughs. And then the episode ends.
And then the episode ends. It's like, next week.
Mm-hmm.
Do my best not to hit play a day early, a week early.
You probably
have finished the series by now.
Oh no, I haven't. I had a chance to, but I am looking forward to seeing the end of this arc.
Yeah,
and obviously we're finishing up.
I think we have two more movies.
That's right, two more
for this TAS. We'll be finishing up two more Cellcast episodes,
mm-hmm.
a total of four episodes, and then we're going to take a short break because you had a vacation come up
mm-hmm.
in a way last minute.
Yeah,
but
it was one of those things where you started planning, but it's still too. It's too much of a time crunch.
And then things kind of just fell into place.
Accelerated. It's like, okay.
Okay, yeah, we'll do that. We'll just take a week off.
Yeah, we'll be fine.
But in that vein, it is actually going to time out just right. We didn't plan this.
No.
This is just how it worked.
Yeah.
We're going to finish Spy Family before you leave, and then when you come back,
mm-hmm.
we will be coming back with a new TAS series
mm-hmm.
of your choosing. We have the poll in our Facebook group.
Yes.
Go vote. In 2 weeks, we're closing the poll. Get over to our Facebook group, The Cell Nation, right now. It's pinned to the top of the page. Find the poll and go vote for either Batman the Animated Series, Gravity Falls, DuckTales, woohoo, ooh. 2016, or Star Trek the Animated Series. Go vote for one of those four. Yeah. Whichever one you want, you see us review. We're going to review all four of them.
Yeah.
This is just the order in which we're going to review it. So
exactly.
If you want us to spend some nights in Gotham over the course of the next 6 months, probably?
6 months, at least.
Go vote for that now.
Yeah. Or DuckTales.
Ooh.
Or Gravity Falls.
Or Star Trek. Although, admittedly, I think when I last looked at it, everything's going to have a hard time beating Batman.
Yeah, just a little bit, because it's Batman.
So, yeah, join us for that.
Yes.
In the meantime, this has been Drew.
This is Jacob.
And we'll catch you in the next frame.
You can follow Jacob on his Facebook at Jacob B. Heron. His Facebook page, Jacob's Daily Art Corner, where he tries to draw each and every day. His Instagram at Jacob B. Heron. His Twitter at Jacob Heron,
and his letterboxed at Jacob Heron. You can find Drew on Facebook at Drew Dodgen. His Facebook page Drew's Photo Bin to see his photography. His letterboxed page at GGeorge759. His Twitter at GGeorge759. And Instagram at Drew Dodgen. You can like us on Facebook at The Cellcast Podcast. On Twitch at The Cellcast Gaming. On YouTube at Cellcast. On Twitter at cast_cell. The Cellcast can be found at Apple Podcasts, Google Play Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, or anywhere else fine podcasts are downloaded from. Please rate and review us where you found us, and also on Podchaser. Email us at thecellcastpodcast@gmail.com. The Cellcast is a proud member of both the Pop Americana and Culture Box media networks. For more information, please see the link in the description. Our theme song is Drop and Roll by Silent Partner. And remember, that's Cell with a single L.
Empire Gaming in our chat is asking if we were thinking of amoxicillin as the nasty stuff that Yor was making. I actually have a better idea.
Oh gosh, what?
Boiled colonoscopy prep.
Oh jeez.
It's probably what that stuff tasted like.
Oh. Haven't you done that yet?
Oh, no.
Neither have I. But the fact that that's generally considered the worst drink ever made by mankind.